And hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of Red Modeling PaintCast. Glad to have you here tonight. My name's Ashton. I'm the your bearded host behind the brush. And thanks for sticking around and catching another episode tonight. Appreciate it. We got here, as you can see on your screen, a Cygnar charger. I'm painting this up for JT. And one of the things that he wanted me to cover as I was doing this paint cast, which we talked quite a bit about last time I did this one, or I worked on the charger for him, was talking about two brush blending techniques over a large area. And the charger here was actually a great model for him to pick to demo this on, because he's got some nice big round shoulders you can see there, and then some good areas to demonstrate shadow and highlight a little bit. So what I'm going to be covering tonight on this guy here, though, is talking about creating true metallic metal techniques with two brush blending. Now, many of you I know are aware of the term NMM, or non-metallic metal techniques. And basically, that's when you use paint, you know, typical paint as far as, you know, grays and blues and browns, to create a metallic-like look. The interesting thing about the non-metallic metal effect, of course, is that's how artists have been doing it in their paintings for thousands of years, hundreds of years, maybe not thousands, more like hundreds. So it's nothing new. Lot of resources out there to recreate that type of effect. Personally, I'm not a big fan of non-metallic metal. I think it takes a lot of work. I think it, if not done right, it looks really weird. And yeah, you know, that's not what what these paint casts are about either. You know, these paint casts are about learning the skills, learning the techniques, learning the methods behind getting your army painted quickly and getting it on the table. So so that's what we're doing here. So the term true metallic metals, okay, so if you got non-metallic metals, then what is a true metallic metal? A true metallic metal is where you are using those same paints again, except this time a metallic-based paint, to create those shadows and those highlights on the metal and to give it more depth, more texture, more contrast, more variety. And so you'll use it when you're doing true metallic metal techniques. You're going to use a combination of typical flat acrylic paints and metallic paints. So I'll demonstrate that a little bit tonight as I kind of go through how to do that on the Cygnar charger here. Before we get to that, though, I do want to make a special announcement to you guys. I talked about this a little bit, I think, last week, if I remember right. But on May 24th, I'm actually going to be on Painting with Menoth John, the podcast. Those of you who know John Christensen, the podfather, Menoth John, he's known by, a lot of people know him, he's a great guy. He does a lot for this community, for the gaming community in general, and is just really all around a fun guy to be with. So he's going to have me on his show on May the 24th. You can catch it on YouTube, where he streams live. And the reason why I'm kind of making an announcement out of that is because I'm going to be announcing at that podcast with John. I've got a real special announcement that I'm going to be making regarding lock and load, and something that's going to happen in association with that. Of course, that's lock and load's a little over a month away, and a lot of fun things happen there. I'm really excited about it. It's going to be my first big major convention that I'm going to, so I'm excited about that. But make sure you tune in on the 24th and to hear what that announcement is. It's going to be pretty cool. Looking at the also at the chat from the Twitch TV stream, looks like someone asked. He said, "Where did the Where did the name Red Modeling Paint Studio come from? Did you just paint everything red for a while, or did you frequently bleed all over your models? So I'm in good company here. We all like miniatures, we all like gaming, so I think I'm safe to say this, but I was introduced to role-playing games when I was about 12 or 13 years old by my older cousin, and we were playing, I don't even remember the name of the game that we were playing, but I was some kind of pilot in a fighter jet, and I was trying to think about what my call sign would be, and the idea came to me of a finger, you know, someone giving someone the finger, you know, the middle finger up, like a red hand with a finger like that against a black background, and the call sign Red Finger. I thought, oh, that sounds pretty cool. We'll go with that. So that just kind of stuck with me. I don't know why. And as far as the red modeling painting goes, red is a fantastic color. I love it. I've painted a lot of red things in my life. I think really the first miniatures that I really started painting seriously were probably my Blood Angel army for 40K when I was into that, and it kind of stuck. So the red is kind of stuck around, Red Finger's kind of stuck around. Maybe one of these days I'll actually get someone who's better at drawing than I am to draw that call sign up for me, and I can use that as an avatar or something. I don't know. Might be kind of offensive though. But anyway, that's where that comes from, Drolath. So I hope that answers your question. So anyway, make sure and check out Painting with Menoth John. Also, you'll notice in the bottom left-hand corner of the screen, I've got a image up there for Discount Games Incorporated. Jay's good friend of mine. He's done a lot to help me out with this and given me a lot of advice and direction. And the least I can do is repay that favor to him by throwing up this advertisement up here for him. So if you go to Discount Games, you buy some models, make sure you let him know you got them from, or you heard about them from me, so that way he knows he is appreciated for his help. So let's talk about the charger here. Let's talk about the charger and let's talk about creating true metallic metal effects. So JT, this model, the blue, I haven't made a lot of more progress on the blue since we last talked. And, you know, that's fine. We talked about that, so we're good with that. I did, you know, of course, get all the metallic areas done, and those are good to go. And what I want to talk about now is how we're going to shade these metals and how we're going to give some depth and some variety to it. The base coat for these metals was P3 pig iron is what I used. So as you are working on your Cygnar army, I would suggest the same thing. I'm also going to do some gold work tonight too, after we do a little bit of shading on these surfaces. So to shade these metallic areas, what I'm going to recommend we start with is going to be kind of a color that I use as a general shading color for a lot of different projects. It's not just going to be unique to this project. This is kind of a shading recipe that I use a lot. So, and what it is it's a combination of P3 umbral umber and P3 coal black. Okay. And what you're going to start with is about a one-to-one mix of the two colors. What it creates is a very, very, very dark brown-blue color, almost black. And what's nice about that is you end up getting the shading benefits of a black color without the lack of contrast that black has. Okay, that's the problem with shading with black is you lose contrast, you lose depth out of it, okay? So by creating this very nice, dark, black, blue, brown color, you're effectively creating a black with texture, a black with depth, a black with contrast. And what it allows you to do is create shadows and then you can actually deepen those shadows with the black. And we'll talk about that. But when you create, when you mix up a one-to-one mixture of that color, what you end up with is something that looks about like that. And as you can see, that looks pretty darn black. But if I water it out and start thinning it out a little bit, you can see the color that is actually in there. Okay, and that's what's so nice about this particular shading color, this particular mix of coal black and umbral umber, is it's a very diverse color. I'll shade leather with this, I'll shade blues with this, I'll shade reds with this, I'll shade greens with this. I mean, it's a very versatile shading mixture. So for those of you who are on the PaintCast watching too, you get that nice little benefit of getting that little gem tonight. So enjoy it, put it in your quiver, and use it. So what I'm going to do here is we're just going to two brush blend the shadows now on these metallic areas. And the idea is, instead of using a darker metallic color to create the shadow, we're just going to use actual paint to create the shadow. And that's going to do two things. That's going to not only add a little bit of contrast to the metallic finish, but it's also going to add contrast in the sense of taking away that sheen. Okay, metallic surfaces have that light that reflects off it. You can see it there as I'm moving the model around. But when you use regular paint to shade the metal with, you're taking that away. You're taking that shine away, which creates that depth, which creates that optical illusion of shading. Okay, and so it makes sure your metallics look like they have a lot more depth to them than they would otherwise have. And you can do the same thing with your highlights too. Okay, you know, you can highlight up to the brightest metallic paint that you have, which in the P3 line would be Quicksilver, I believe. Maybe type platinum, radiant platinum. But then you can take regular like white paint, like Moro white, and put that on top of that, and even push that highlight even further and create a lot more contrast. Okay, so you kind of got some options there, and that's a good thing. So I'm just updating real quick the title of this stream so that way people watching know what I'm working on. Okay, so we'll start right here. Okay, I'm gonna add a nice strong shadow right along this edge, and then at the bottom, and bring it up a little bit. And then you can see how this color looks when it's applied as a shadow. And remember, when you're two brush blending, work on that surface back and forth, push into the paint, and then pull out. And I think I have just a little too much paint on there, so we're just going to work it for a moment here and wipe off any excess. I wasn't quite paying attention to how much I had on my brush there. That's one of the advantages, though, of two-brush blending, is you can make those kind of corrections on the fly fairly easy. And there you go, you can see the depth that already adds just in that first pass. And now we're just going to start working our way around the model on different spots here. And as some of these areas dry, we can go back and I can talk about some other effects that you can add. creating or enhancing that true metallic metal effect. And I think the two brush blending actually goes a lot faster on metallic surfaces for some reason. I'm not sure why. Not sure what makes that happen, but it works. It goes quick. Sure you guys can hear all that running around upstairs. It sounds like the wife and kids are home. I'm not going anywhere, so don't worry. They know tonight's a broadcast night for me, so. All right, so that boiler, just a few minutes of two brush blending work, and you can see how much that that changes things up on it. And, you know, like I was mentioning last week too, don't be greedy. Work a little bit at a time, okay? And it will slowly build up that coat, that color, okay? The Junkie 42, not sure why you're not getting any volume. Everything's fine on my end. Sometimes Twitch, if you just turned in, are just tuned in rather, sometimes takes a minute for Twitch to catch up with the delay. So just hang tight and be interested if anyone else is not getting any sound. Now, JT, one thing we didn't talk about was how dirty or clean you want the Cygnar to be. I mean, everyone knows that Cygnar plays dirty, but as far as the appearance goes, we didn't talk a lot about that. So I am going to do a little bit of weathering on the boiler here and on some of these metal areas just to demonstrate some stuff to you, but I'm not going to get too excessive with it. I think I'm going to come back up here now to these smokestacks and add some more in there now that that base coat has had some time to dry. Hey Gideon, what's up, bud? Yeah, I'm doing a show right now, so I'll have to talk to you later, okay? Yeah, you can leave it open a little bit, pal. All right, love you, man. That's fine, pal. I don't know how many of you guys out there have kids, but. Tell you, it's a great feeling coming home at night and seeing those guys. And here in a couple years when they get old enough, I'm going to have me perpetual people that I can win against when I play War Machine. At least until they learn the game better than I do. Or until they decide to play Cygnar, one of the two. that's coming along really well. You can really start to see some of that contrast building up. Now, what's really going to make this pop, though, and I'll just demonstrate it real fast, so those on the live feed can see it. I'm going to add some highlights now, okay? And I'm going to jump straight to Quicksilver for this. I'm not going to worry about the cold still intermediate. I'm just going to go straight to that. Yeah, Troll Bearcat, yeah, and Perpetual Paint Slaves. You know what the funny story there is? I've actually done some commissions where I've been painting, like, you know, 30, 40 troops, okay? And when I'm doing that many troops on a commission, I speed paint them, and very rarely are they painted to, like, you know, a show standard. It's really just a tabletop quality, because, you know, who would be able to afford, you know, that? That'd just be a lot of money. Anyway, so I use a lot of washes, and I've actually taught my daughter how to apply a wash now on a model. And so when I get to some of those big projects like that where I'm just doing assembly line painting, I actually will put her to work doing washes. So yeah, you're right, perpetual slaves. Yeah, there you go. All right, so highlight. Let's just start in an obvious place, right here on the top of the boiler, right there. We're going to add a hot, nice, strong highlight right there, okay? And then we'll two brush blend that in. And then that's when you'll really start to see some of this contrast being created with a true metallic metal effect. There you go. And you see how you get that nice highlight, but you also get that really flat shade as well. We can do the same thing right here at the tops of these stacks. And I don't know if when I'm doing these highlights, if it's as much of a two-brush blend type thing, or if it's more of like a feathering or softening of the edge. Metallics are just a little bit more forgiving than non-metallic paint, and so I don't think the bathtub ring effect shows up quite as bad. So I think you can be a little more aggressive with how quick your jump is between your shadow and your highlight. It doesn't have to be quite so smooth on the metallics. If anything, I think it kind of adds to that overall hammered kind of look that you know, some metals can have. And what we would do on the rivets here along this strap is we're just going to hit the top of each one with some of this Quicksilver. Actually, that cap I'm going to paint gold, so I'm not going to go too much onto that one. Soften that up just a little bit more there. All right, and you can just see how that slowly starts to build up and create a nice weathered look. Now I want to talk a little bit about adding a little bit of a weathered effect to this boiler right here, in the form of a rust or a discoloration in the model. So for that, we're going to use Umbral Umber again, and then P3 Bloodstone. Okay. And what you're going to do is put these two colors on your wet palette. Okay, and put yourself a drop or brush load of your umbral umber, and then a drop or brush load of your bloodstone. And put them on your wet palette right next to each other. And, well, not right next to each other, but, you know, in the same area. Okay. And then start with your umbral umber. Thin it out fairly well. This is about how thin I have it. Okay. And then immediately, while it's still thin like that, just take a small dot of the bloodstone. Don't clean the brush, just a small dot of the bloodstone, and then on your hand, or preferably on your hand, don't do it on your on a paper towel, just kind of dab it on your hand like that, okay? So you'll have a rough mixture of the color on your brush, and then, like in this little corner right here, we're just going to put some of that right there, and I'm just going to kind of dot it on, and then take your wet brush, your blending brush, and then just kind of soften the edge. You see how I'm just kind of dabbing a little bit? Okay, and you can see that touch of rust that it adds, okay? Kind of do the same thing right there, except this time I'm going to blend it vertically. And I'm just softening the edges, okay? I'm not going very far into the paint at all. All right, you can see that little bit of rust now that adds, just a touch of it. You know, Cygnar, I guess, probably keeps their stuff fairly clean, so we don't want to give them too much of a hassle for it, right? And then if you want something that is just more of a rust, you know, more orange rust type look, let's add it on these little rivets right here. I'm just going to put a drop of that bloodstone color right there. And again, using my blending brush, just soften those edges up. And there you go, creating just a little bit of a rust effect without being too overpowering. That's the thing when it comes to weathering metals, you don't want it to be an overpowered effect. You want it to be really subtle and not taking up a lot of space there. So, Troll Bearcat, you said I've never considered using the washes to create a blend in that manner. I'll have to try that. Can I show you a picture of new things for me to work on when I get done with finals next week? So the way you're wording that, it sounds like you're potentially a client of mine. I don't recognize the username, but if you're just someone who's wanting me to ask me to look at some stuff that you've painted, sure, send it over to my email, redmodeling@gmail.com. But if you're actually a client, or if this is JT, make sure to let me know, so that way I can promptly respond to your questions when you ask them in chat. Okay, so let's move on to shading some more areas here. So we'll start working on this hip area right here. And actually, real quick, I'm going to actually use this shadow color that I mixed up, the mixture of a coal black and umbral umber, and just kind of apply it to this whole area right here. And the reason why I'm doing that is because I don't want to just leave this area looking unfinished, so I'm just going to paint it this very dark shadow color to make it look as if it, you know, has depth to it. And then that will also blend it well with the shadow that I'm mixing up onto the hip right now. Coming down here to the foot now. Just trying to build up the shadow a little bit more. There we go, that one looks pretty good there. There's a painter out there who's a much better painter than I am. His name is Matthew Fontaine. He's a guy from Canada. Fantastic work. I mean, the guy's amazing. And anyway, he does this paint technique quite a bit of the shading with metallics, or shading with shading metallics with non-metallic colors. And he is fantastic at it, and he has just done some amazing work. If you Google him on Facebook or look him up on Facebook, Matthew Fontaine, I forget the name of his painting studio. I can never pronounce it anyway. But yeah, he does some really, really amazing work. And this is a good example too of my painting ADD that I get sometimes. I've gone from the boiler to the hip to the foot, now to the waist. I just hop all around. And now to the shoulder. Can see what I'm working on here. Always when I'm working on these inner details, you know, inner parts of the foot or inner parts of the legs, it's always gets a little more hard to see because of the lighting. I was on Amazon the other day and I was actually looking at photography lights, you know, the kinds with the big white umbrellas on them that diffuse the light out, and seriously considering upgrading the light here in my painting studio a little better so that it's I don't have so much shadow created on what I'm painting, and it creates more of a global lighting scheme. So we'll see if that ever happens, though. Those things are pricey. How many of you guys actually are painting your own stuff when you watch these streams? I'm curious about that. The way some of the previous chats have been going, I would think quite a few. Okay. Just gonna keep working around here, getting the shadow in all these spots. One of these days, I've been kind of thinking about maybe doing a freestanding paint cast, you know, not one for a specific client, on speed painting, and just you know, taking like an errant, like an exemplar errant or something like that, something from my own army, and just seeing how quickly I can paint it using, you know, a lot of the techniques that I use while explaining it on camera. You know, it's one thing to do this when, you know, I've got a little bit of music in the background, or, you know, my wife hanging out here talking to me, or, you know, movie on or whatever. But it's another thing to be doing it while I'm explaining to people how to do it, and, you know, producing a video to make sure, you know, it's of a good enough quality. So, that would be that'd be fun. That'd be a fun paint cast, I think, to do. I just real quick want to point out the effect that painting this area creates. So when you're like looking at the model from the side, or, you know, from this type of a perspective, when you've got that area painted all black or dark like that, it creates a nice border, I guess you could say. It creates a nice separation between colors, so it doesn't just look like it's a big blob of steel or a big blob of blue. It actually kind of defines it and separates that hip joint from the thigh plates a little bit more. I mean, when you look at it from this way, yeah, it looks kind of weird, but you know, just kind of generally speaking, and you know, in the terms of creating a nice, clean-looking final product, you know, it's a good little technique. It's a good little thing to pick up. It kind of falls under that realm of black lining that I've talked about a few times, you know, but it's a lot thicker, a lot heavier of a type of black line. Of course, that in there is going to be a little difficult to get to. You guys aren't really going to be able to see that just because the angle I have to hold that at, so. Sorry about that. So, Troll Bear Cat. Oh, yeah, that's a cool Tyranid model, man. I like that. I don't know if you saw that Tyranid army that Lester from Awesome Paint Job is working on, but he's working on a purple cream color Tyranid army right now, and it looks fantastic. That's going to be a fun model to paint, man. I like how that looks. Thanks for putting the link up, man. Very cool. Okay, let's keep chugging along here. You know, talking about my kids, or speaking about my kids earlier too, I've actually had the idea a couple times because my daughter, she turned 7 a few months ago, and she's actually a really fantastic artist for someone her age, and she's really interested in learning how to paint miniatures, and I thought it might be kind of fun to do a paint cast with her one day here coming up, and you know, just kind of teaching her some of the basics about painting. I think it would be kind of cool. Something like that would probably get it like a million likes on YouTube just because of the cuteness factor of it. I don't know. Okay. I think I need to move on to this hip now, and then the foot, and then all the shading on the metals here will be done, and I can move on to some highlights. And then working a little bit on the gold trim too. Okay, get the inside foot right here. And a lot of this metallic area down here below, you know, below the waistline, so to speak, I'm not going to be highlighting that because I want that to, you know, appear further down on the model. I'm going to create the illusion of shadow it being further away than the focal point, that sort of thing. So, you know, so a lot of these areas they're going to be done once I finish these initial shading colors here. Okay. See, we'll just add a dot there. is about it on the metallic, on the silver metallic here. Create a little bit of a shadow here. Okay. All right. Now for some highlights now. Oh, let me pick this detail out too. This will just take a second. I'm going to thin this shading color down just a little bit more to nice wash consistency. And I'm just going to run that over these details right here. Back into here a little more. And then, of course, JT, the screws, you know, details like that all around, those will all be picked out too. In fact, I'll just show you real quick how I do it. I don't use the base color for that. I actually use the highlight color for that. I'll just load a little on my brush there and just start working the color into the rivet. Might take a coat or two because I've got it fairly thinned down at this point after sitting on my wet palette for a few minutes. But that's what you want. You don't want to get too messy with it and get out of that, you get it all over that blue there. Just let that dry before we put another coat on there. But let's do a little bit of highlighting here real quick. So that way we can get a few of these details to stand out. And I'm actually not even really wet blending these at this point. I'm just kind of feathering the edge as I pull away from it. And the purpose there is just to create the. I'm trying to create the illusion of the highlight. I'm not really necessarily trying to add the highlight because there's already, and it's not showing up quite as well on the camera, but there's already quite a bit of contrast here, and it. It's actually showing up pretty good. So I lied about the feet. I'm going to add just a little bit of highlight on the feet, but just right at the edges. Nothing too crazy here. Just softly picking out some of these details. Some of the piping. Not the recessed areas of the piping, but just those areas that are standing out. Now some of these other metal areas will have to be done later, which is fine. You know, work on one little bit at a time. Okay. So coming along, looking pretty good. Let's start adding some metallic colors now. I mean some gold colors, and start building those up. And what I'll do once I get the golds on and get those all weathered, get the blues all weathered, I'm going to come back and pick out some more of these details in just regular straight white. And really get that going. I do want to add just to keep the effect going throughout the model. I'm just going to add a little bit of that rust color right down in here. And again, I'm just adding a little bit of it, JT. And if you decide you don't like it, you know, after seeing this video, that's cool, man. Let me know. I'll go back and take it off. But I just thought it would be a nice little thing to demonstrate for you for future models. Oh, JT, I see you on there now, Dazi Osmendias. Nice, thanks for being on, man. So skeletons, they're sold out of it, huh? Hangar 18 sold out of the scale 75 gold set. That's a bummer, man. I've seen them on eBay. I don't know if you are cool with shopping there, but I have seen them there, and might be a place to check out too. Because, yeah, if you can get your hands on some of those, man, they're fantastic. They really are. Okay, so let's actually move on to some scale 75 gold paint. And I'm going to just do a couple of the parts base coated in this color. And then I'll probably wrap up JT's paint cast for the night on the charger here, and move on to something else for the last hour or so of the night. So, let me just mix some of this up real quick. JT, I don't know if you were on earlier when I was adding in a little bit of the rust effects here on the boiler. So if you're not digging that, make sure and let me know so I can change that off, but or take that off. But how do you like the metal effects, the steel color, generally speaking now? Is that satisfactory? Is that what you were looking for as color-wise goes? For the base gold colors that I'm going to be using, I'm going to start with scale 75 Dwarven Gold. It's very, very similar to the solid gold, rulet gold combination that the P3 Studio scheme uses. Very similar to that. So on these knees, on the knee here, the upper plate, I'm going to paint gold. The lower plate, I will come back and do silver. And I'm not going to go gold all the way back. I am going to add some of that shadow color back in there on the top once I get that base coat firmly established. I think what I'll work on after I'm done wrapping up here with the charger for the night is I'm going to pull some cephalics out. And someone on Facebook, a friend of mine, Eric, who is down in Utah, he's been struggling a little bit with using the scale 75 paints. And so I think I might take a few minutes. And since I'm using the scale 75 quite a bit on the cephalics army, take some time to talk about that, talk about how I use them and the ways that that I've had success with them. So when I'm done here, I'll need just a couple minutes to kind of reset for or set up for the Cephalex, and then I'll be back on to work on that. So for those of you who are wanting to stick around and chat, definitely don't go anywhere. Stick around so that you can catch that part of the PaintCast as well. Good, JT. I'm glad you like it. Just responded in chat there. So you haven't missed too much as I've been going through this. Probably the most exciting thing that you've missed is my comments to how dirty Cygnar are when they play. So hopefully my opinion on that doesn't ruin our professional relationship here. Not trying to get any kind of single coat coverage out of this gold. That's fine if it doesn't coat all the way the first time. In fact, you don't necessarily want it to. I'm just trying to get it nice even coat down so that that way when I come back and add a second coat, it's not going to look lumpy. It'll look nice and smooth. That's what we want. Drolath just replied in the chat on Twitch here regarding my comments about my bitterness, my saltiness towards Jay, or towards Cygnar. See, I even slipped on it there. He said it's not like he's. Oh, let me read it here. It's like he's had to play against Jay on a regular basis or something. Jay's actually a really great player to play with. He does a really good job of. Especially if you tell him beforehand that, you know, you're wanting to have an educational experience. He does a great job of delivering on that. I remember a couple months back, I was trying out the Vessel of Judgment for the first time on for my Manoth army. and he dropped Cygnar against me, of course, and I think it was his one variation of his Haley Stormwall list. And you know, I thought, you know, with a Devout and Mechanics and Defender's Ward from P. Krios, you know, I thought my Vessel of Judgment was safe, you know, so I got a little aggressive with it probably, and I told him beforehand that, you know, I was trying this out for the first time and I wanted to know, you know, what I had to be worried about, you know, that type of a thing, gosh, I think it took him half of his turn on one turn to take my vessel off the table. So I sit there the rest of the game with basically nothing to handle the Stormwall sitting across the table from me. So anyway, yeah, Jay's a great opponent. If you get a chance to play him, definitely take it because he's a good guy. I may be salty about Cygnar, but I'm not salty to the point that Scott was. Scott was very much a Cygnar hater. Looking pretty good. That's right. I wanted to do this little cap back here in gold just to break up all that silver. And then we're going to do this box in gold. And then this vent here. Those will all dry. And then, of course, these plates right up here. We're going to do those in gold as well. All right, so I'm going to set this aside now, let it dry before moving on to applying those base coats even further. JT, did you have any specific question for me on this so far? While we're waiting for the delay to catch up with him so he can answer that question, I'm looking at chat. It says, do you use different brushes when you're painting your metallics versus regular colors? Yeah, I was using a different brush. I was just using one of my cheap synthetics there. The reason why is I like to keep my, when I'm doing base coats with metallics, I just notice that it tends to be a little harder on brushes. I don't know if that's everybody's experience, but that's been mine. So I just tend to use kind of one of my cheap synthetics for just putting down a base coat on my metallics. It just tends to prolong the life of my good brushes a little bit longer. So, okay, so no questions from JT then. So, I'm going to email you then in the next few days, JT, and we'll talk about where we go from here on the charger, and probably it'll be just one more paint cast on him, and then this will be in the box to you for you to have, so along with all the paint recipes and everything that we've talked about. So for those of you who are going to be sticking around, hang out for about the next 5 minutes. I'm going to log off for just a second. Well, not stop the stream. The stream will run. But just turn the camera off for a minute while I reset. The next bit of paint casting is going to involve working with the Cephalix army that I have, and specifically working with the scale 75 paints. So hang out, guys, for a few minutes, and I'll be back in just a moment. Thanks.